morning, church. Good to see everybody here, and it's also good to see everybody enjoying the fellowship that we have in the Lord, and the warm feeling that we get when we see our brothers and sisters here and to visit with them. A few announcements before we begin our service this morning. If you're visiting with us, you are our honored guest, and please stay around. Let us get to know you just a little bit better. And then we do have a fellowship meal today, so if you're visiting, then be sure to stay around, and we'll feed you back here in a few minutes. Okay, a couple of things then. We've got a children's party coming up on the 10th. It's going to be up here at the pizza place. And if you're bringing children, if you're planning on bringing a friend, please do, but let Helen or Michelle know no later than Wednesday night. Also, we'll need a count of adults that plan on coming also, so kind of make some preparations for that event. So again, if you're coming to the pizza party, it's going to be at the Retro Pizza here in town. And it looks like it's going to be from 12 to 3 on December the 10th, young folks. So that's the children's holiday party. The adults have got one coming up too, I think, but I'll not mention that just now. There is a Christmas card in the foyer for Rick and Kathy on the table where the bulletins are at. Everyone, please sign, if you would, please. Back in the new building here to our left, we're getting ready for insulation in there. And so we got plastic laid down on the floor. And, you know, believe it or not, I was a young person at one time, and I loved to run in the building. And I got scolded and got a few whippings for that. But anyway, young folks, if you would, please, we'd love to see you here. I myself love to see these young people here every day. But please stay off the plastic until after we get that up out of there, because it's slippery and you might fall. And we're planning on having the building insulated, and that's in lieu of that. So please be mindful of that. 5 o'clock this evening, there will be a meeting for the jail ministry. So if you're working in that ministry, please come to that meeting, and we will talk about things that we might do to improve that ministry. And I see Clifford's here this morning. I told him I was going to announce that he's here. Been gone for about 3 weeks, and we've been missing him, but he's feeling better. And there may be others, too, that are here this morning that haven't been here for a while because of sickness. And we're glad to see you all. I believe that's about all of the announcements that I have. If I've missed anything. Before we begin our worship service then, I think it's a good custom, and we used to do this all the time, I'd like to read from God's Word, and then we'll have a prayer, and then we'll begin the worship. I'll be reading from Luke, the 6th chapter. I'm going to be reading verses 20 through 26. Then he, the Lord talking, then he lifted his eyes toward his disciples and said, Blessed are your poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you and revile you and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in the day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven, for in like manner the fathers did to the prophets. But woe unto you who are rich, for you have received your conciliation. Woe unto you who are full, for you shall hunger. Woe unto you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. "Woe unto you when all men speak well of you, for so did the fathers and the false prophets." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. And now let us pray as we enter into our worship service together. Bow with me, please. Heavenly Father, we bow before you as the great God of all that is. We honor you with our lives, Father, and with these songs of praise today. And we pray that your name be glorified in all that we do, and that we be uplifted by doing that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. If you'd like to take a songbook, the first song will be number 678, "More About Jesus." We'll sing the first, second, and last verses. More about Jesus would I know, more of his grace to others show, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me. More, more about Jesus, more, more about Jesus, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me. More about Jesus, let me
Before we're led in prayer, let's sing number 769, May I Call You Father. And after this, Brother Ron will lead us in prayer.
Bow with me, please. Dear gracious God in heaven, we're gathered together this morning as one body to worship you, Father, and bring honor and glory to you. We want to ask, Father, that you be with us as the love that flows from heart to heart is truly love that brings glory to you and makes you look down upon us and be glad that you can call us sons and daughters. We thank you, Father, for your goodness and mercy in sending Jesus Christ, our Savior, to come on this earth. Give us an example, give us instruction, show us how to love, show us how to obey, and show us, Father, how to lift one another up. And Father, we pray that we might always honor that first and great commandment to love you with all our heart and all our soul and all our might. And Father, that we look to the second commandment as well, the great commandment, to love our brother as ourselves, love our neighbor as ourselves. Pray, Father, we might all consider one another brothers and sisters, but neighbors as well, to reach out and help and do what we can to make life better for those round about us and to bring them as well to the feet of the cross, that they too might look upon it, see the need to put on Christ, their Savior, in baptism and be called sons of God. Father, we have many who are suffering today with various illnesses. We think of Brother Paul suffering from COVID and ask you give him a quick recovery from it. We have others, Father, who have recovered from it. We think of them, especially Joy and Andrea, and pray, Father, that you'd help them to continue to get better. And Father, we think also of Brother Monty Farley, that how he would so long to be with us and to do your will and look about, see to the needs of his neighbors as well. We pray you'd look down upon him and his family and help them, Father, to do what they need to do to make life good for him and for themselves and those round about them. Father, we know that there's a war going on, many wars going on. And we think again of that second commandment, if all of us would just love our neighbor as ourselves, we know that we would want no harm to come to them. And we pray that an end could soon come from this conflict. And we pray for our young soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines that are involved in such conflict, that you would watch over them. We think of Brother Corey and Brothers Jacob, Brother Hayden, and also of Adam Hockman. And we pray, Father, that you'd watch over them all. And as we've just learned this morning that a ship has come under attack in the Red Sea, we pray, Father, that that will be stopped very soon and no harm would come to our sailors and Marines in that battle. Pray, Father, as we continue our worship this morning, you would help us to join in song, each of us to sing out, making those joyful noises, Father, teaching and admonishing one another. We thank you for the songs that Jeff has chosen for us to praise you with this morning. And we look forward to our lesson from Brother Jared and ask your blessing upon him as he brings it this morning. Pray, Father, for the men who will be worshiping publicly and serving us today, that you'd give them humility and honor you in their service. Finally, Father, we think of our children this morning that are worshiping with us, and those that have chosen or have been prevented, whatever the case may be. Pray for those children that you would guide them, help them, Father, to do their best to grow up to be elders, deacons, women, wives of the same, teachers of your word, and watch over them, Father, and guide them to goodness. And help them as well to love you and put you on someday. Bless our teachers. Watch over them, Father, and help them to ever strive to be that good example. And help each of us as we can come in contact with our little children, that we be kind, considerate, patient, understanding, knowing that we're teaching them. Whether we wear that name of teacher or not, we're teaching them and giving examples in all things. Guide us, Father. Forgive us of our sins when we're found lacking. And help us always to do our best. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
To help prepare our minds for the partaking of the Lord's Supper, let's sing number 496. Number 313. We'll get to 496 here in a little bit, but 313. I'm getting ahead of myself. 313, the old rugged cross.
And I love.
as it is each first day of the week, all the acts of worship that we conduct, offering to our Heavenly Father, are sacred. And I've often referred to, we've entered into another sacred part of our worship where we remember the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. I so much appreciate that we do everything as He's asked us to do. We've approached Him with prayer this morning, 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Also, James chapter 5, verse 13 and following shows us the effect of our prayers. We've sang praises to Him, Ephesians 5:19, and I really like that Hebrews 13:15 calls it the fruit of our lips as we praise. We'll have preaching in a moment. In Acts chapter 20, we see that Paul there preached until midnight. But as we take these emblems, we also have the indication there in Acts chapter 20 how important it was to Paul that he tarried for time to be with his brethren to break bread. And in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, he waited. We also see it was something they did every first day of the week in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. When Paul writes to them in chapter 11, verse 17, "Now in this I declare unto you, I praise you not that ye come together, not for the better, but for the worse." When they were coming together, they made it a very casual thing. They made it a casual dinner, if you will. They weren't remembering the Lord and Jesus Christ. They came and went with their dinner. And he says in the next verse, "For first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that that there are divisions among you, and I partly believe it." And then he says, "Don't you have homes in which you can partake of a common meal together or come and go?" So he re-instructs them in verse 23 and following, "For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he came to, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, This is the cup in the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me." And so we have here the indication from Paul that this is something we're to gather together and to do, to remember the importance of it in his death, burial, and resurrection, his body, his blood, as the emblems. And as we partake of these things at this time, let's put the things in the world to aside as we have the prayer for the bread.
Would you bow with me, please? Our most gracious, kind, and heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this opportunity for us to partake of these emblems and to reaffirm what we truly believe, that Christ is the King. And we do this in a manner which we hope will be well-pleasing to Him. As we take this bread and we break it together, that we'll remember His body that was broken to help us and to allow our sins to be forgiven, that we may praise and honor Him. And this we pray in Christ's most holy name. Amen.
you, Almighty and Holy Father God, for your beautiful love. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son, our Lord and Savior, who willingly left his glory in heaven and came down to this earth and laid his life down at Calvary to pay for our sin debt. We ask, Father, that you help us to always be mindful of the great sacrifice that you and your Son made for us. We ask, Father, that you help us to live our lives accordingly, to live a life that will be acceptable to thee. As we prepare to take this fruit of the vine, which represents Christ's blood in the new covenant, we ask that we do so in a manner that is pleasing and acceptable to thee. Pray in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
there anyone overlooked? As we lay by in store, let's put our hearts and minds in the places we give. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul writes there the purpose of why we give. In verse 12 he says, "For if there be a willing mind, it is acceptable, according to that a man hath, not according to what he hath not. For I mean not that other men be eased and ye be burdened, but by inequality, that now at this time your abundance may also supply for their want, and their abundance also may be a supply for your want, that there may be equality. As it is written, he that had gathered much had nothing over, and he that had gathered little had no lack."
Please bow. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for all your many wonderful blessings. Most of all, we thank you for your Son, our Savior. As we have this opportunity to give back, may we do it in a way that pleases you, Father. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before Brother Jared brings us our lesson, we'll sing number 496, A Listen to the Wondrous Story.
Yeah, one came down from heaven's floor.
like to mark your book. The song of invitation will be number 940, Only a Step. Brother Jared?
Good morning. Rick is in Iberia, so Paul asked me to preach this morning, so I was all, yes, sir. I'm always willing to get up and preach. And no, Dan, I'm not going to go until midnight, so don't worry about that. Where is Christ put in your life? As the screen says, we need to put Christ first every day. In the book of Colossians, in Colossians 2, that will be where we are today, 2 and 3, we are told a few things that we need to do so that we can put God or Christ first. The first one we see is that we have to not have worldly knowledge, but Christ. In verses 1 through 10, we see this. The first thing it says, "For I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and those in Laodicea, that for as many have not seen my face in flesh, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, and in love, and attaining of the righteous the riches of the full assurance of understanding, in the knowledge of the mystery of God, both in Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Not now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you and in persuasive words." We'll stop right there for just a minute. We are to have knowledge of God and Jesus, but we need to be very careful not to take in those things that are taken out of context by the others, because they are deceiving, as it says. Persuasive words. We need to be careful in that. For though, in verses 5 through 10, it says, "For those I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in spirit. Rejoice to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As you, therefore, have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abound in the thanksgiving, in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophies and empty deceit, according to the traditions of men, according to the basic principles of the word, and not according to Christ." For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And you are complete in him, who is the head of all principalities and power. He's telling us, you can be gaining this wisdom, this power, this knowledge through the philosophies of this world. But if they are contrary to Christ, beware. Don't do them. We are to be taking on Christ, doing the things that Christ wants us to do, not the world. In 1 Corinthians 3, verses 18 and 19, he tells the Corinthians basically the same thing. He says, let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seem to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of the world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. He wants us to be wise. Another way to gain the principalities that we have, or the philosophies that are taught in the way in the world. We need to be wise and go with God's wisdom and not the wisdom of the world. This is something a lot of the world is having problems with. They want to gain all this knowledge, all this wisdom that the world offers. But they want to turn their back on what the real knowledge that we need. In 2 Peter 1, verses 2 through 4, we can see what the real knowledge we need is. And there Peter writes, grace and peace be multiplied in you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who calls us by the glory and virtue by which have been given us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. This is what we are given. We are given this so that we can have what it takes. It says that we are, his divine power has given us all things. His words have given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Through that knowledge we have of him. This is the type of knowledge that we need. Not the ones that can't help us in this world, but take us from God. We need Christ's knowledge, the knowledge of him, so that we can grow properly. We'll have the next slide, the next verses down through there, in 2 Peter. But this just came in my head. I do this a lot. It comes in there quickly, and then it vanishes. That's just quickly. But in those next verses, it says that we are to grow, to be diligent to grow spiritually by adding faith, knowledge, all those things. But it's the knowledge of God that we need in order to grow properly. We need not to have philosophies or worldly knowledge to be our number one thing, but we need God. We need Christ. The next thing, verses 11 and following, is that we are not to be in the law, but we need Christ. In verses 11 through 13. Paul tells us, in him you may be circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you were all, which you were also will raise with him through faith in the works of God, and raise him from the dead, who raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your heart, he has made alive with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. When Dad's class started this morning, I was hearing all this stuff that he about baptism and all that, and I was like, oh no, I'm going to overlap with him, which is not a bad thing, because we need to be reminded of baptism and all that. But we need not to think about, and at this time the Colossi brethren were having problems. A lot of them were Jews and were still thinking about that law of Moses and the things that were going on with the law of Moses. That's why he says, do not, that we are to be circumcised with Christ's circumcision and not the things of the world, the things that are on the of the old law, but to be buried with him in baptism and raised with him as well. In verses 14 and 15, it continues and says, wiping out the handwriting of requirements that was against us. Those handwritten things was the Ten Commandments. Granted, 9 of the 10 are mentioned in the New Testament for us to do. All but the Sabbath. But they were wiped out. And they were contrary to what we are doing. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Yes, it's for our learning. But the old covenant was put away when Christ died on the cross. Those handwritten things that were given to them are no longer what we have to do. The world thinks that we should still honor them. But we are to honor Christ's law, not the law of the world. When I made this up, it made sense to me. I hope I can explain it. Because when I looked at it this morning after I gave it to Rick, I kind of go, what in the world was I thinking? But to the Jews, the old law was everything. And then they went to Christ's law. But that also goes with the Gentiles. To us today, those that were not raised in the church like I was, my dad was a Methodist when he grew up, he had to take his mind off of things that were Methodist and go to Christ's law the correct way. I did not have that problem. I was raised in the church. I was raised by a preacher, so it was kind of ingrained in me. But if you look at that last one, us, before we were baptized, before we looked at God the correct way, we were in sin as much as the Gentiles were back then. They looked, and then as we grew, like in there in 2 Peter, and did all those things the way that we are supposed to, and then we became a new person in Christ. I was trying to make it look that way. But again, I looked at it and go, what were you doing? But that's what I meant for it to look like. Looking like taking away and going Christ's way. Going from sin, going to Christ. That's what I wanted it to look like. Because when you looked at those verses, if you look back there, you have those circumcision made without hands, Christ's law, buried with him in baptism, and raised with him from the dead. When we are in sin, we are dead. We are in the old law. And now we are alive in Christ, a new person. I hope that makes sense to you. I know it's a little confusing looking at that slide, but I hope I explained it well enough where you understand. The third thing that we need to do is found in Colossians 3, in that we are to give up ourselves and go to Christ. Not ourselves, but Christ. Verses 1 through 4, 1 and following, down through verse 11, we'll continue the reading. It says, if then you were raised with Christ, when you were baptized, you were raised with Christ. Seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting on the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ. Is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ was in our lives appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth. The sin that I was talking about. Fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is come upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked with you, lived in them. When you lived in them. But now you yourself are to be put off of these things. Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of the mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man who has received the knowledge according to the image of the creation, where there is neither Jew or Greek, nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slaves nor free, but Christ in all and in all. We are to forgive or to put off our old self. We are to put our minds away from the old and go anew. When we think of ourselves more than Christ, we are not doing Christ's bidding. In conclusion, Paul tells us what we need to do. We need to be the new man. In verses 12 through 14, or 12 through 17, it describes this new man. and the things that are to, that we are to do with that. And 12 through 12, starting in verse 12, as chapter 3, it says, therefore, as the elect of God, those who have not done these things before, who have put off the knowledge, the old law, themselves, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercy, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you must also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your heart, to which also you were called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching, and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father, through him. If when we put off those other things and we become that new person, we can celebrate with this. Do all, whatever you do, do it in Christ, with Christ. Do it in the name of Jesus. Where are you in your life? Where are you? Are you putting Christ first? Or are you more more mindset of the philosophies, the knowledge, the legalism, the law, or the carnal things? Your own self. What is more important to you? If those other things are more important to you, you need prayers of the saints. You need to come and let us pray for you, because Christ needs to be number one in your life. Or are you one that has not even become a Christian yet? As you looked at those things on the board, think about those things and let them think about so you can be a member of God's family. If you have any need, please let me know as we stand and as we sing.
We thank you, our Father, that we can come before you today, and we pray that the things we did, things we said, our attitudes are pleasing to you. We're thankful for each one that's here. We pray, Father, that as we join the fellowship of the meal back, prepared for us in the back room, Father, that all things will go smoothly, and you will be glorified as well. We're thankful for all the things that we take for granted, but we do thank you most of all for Jesus, for allowing him to come and to die for us. Thankful for the lesson we heard today. May the things we were taught truly guide us and strengthen us. We need to be in Christ. Be with us now and help us, Father, to walk our way. We can guide others to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.